Welcome to DivCasts from the University of Chicago Divinity School. For more of our podcasts and information about our terms of use, please see our website, divinity.uchicago.edu/podcasts.
Quite frequently here at the Divinity School to have interesting scholars who visit us from other institutions, other countries, and this quarter is no different. Professor Dan Laor is visiting from Tel Aviv University. He is teaching a course on the representation of Holocaust in Hebrew literature, and also a course on Agnon, am I getting this correct, who was the first Hebrew writer to receive a Nobel Prize. I would have got it right. My memory skills have not faded yet. And he's also the author of this delightful book, Nathan Alterman, A Biography. Professor Laor swears that this is close to 1,000 pages, and it certainly looks like it is. So you might want to read it. How many of you are taking a course with Professor Laor this quarter? Any students here? Okay. I would certainly take advantage of perhaps even checking into his office hours, sitting in on a class. He is not only a brilliant scholar, but just an utterly pleasant and charming individual, I must say. I've always enjoyed brief conversations with him, and so we're just delighted that he's agreed to share with us today at Wednesday lunch. So would you welcome visiting Professor Dan Laor.
Thank you all. Terry, for thinking about me not as an adequate scholar, but as a good individual. This is much more flattering than the other thing. I'm very, very happy and moved to have the opportunity to be present in this forum and to talk to you. In fact, I came to Chicago 1 month ago. Today I celebrate the first month. I arrived March 23rd, and I really feel at home at the university, particularly in the Divinity School, and really it is for me a great privilege and honor to have the opportunity to say a few words in this context. Soon after arriving to Chicago, I was called for an audience at the office of Dean Margaret Mitchell. I felt like being in an audience. And of course, I wanted to do a good impression. I never trust my own self. So I brought her the book. I assumed that she knew some Hebrew. I didn't expect her to read the book, but at least I thought that she would appreciate the quantity. And as there is also a subtitle in English, so I showed it to her that she wouldn't say that I just took some heavy book from the library and play games with her. And then she is a very attentive person, and she wanted to know about the book, and I told her that this is a biography of, as Terry said, of Nathan Alterman, who is considered the leading, let's say, the national poet of modern Israel. Very much so. He's really, in many ways, the representative of modern Israel. And as my previous biography, Terry mentioned Yosef Agnon, who received the Nobel Prize for Literature in 1966. So I published his biography in 1988. And when I come abroad, people know about him. He's the name because he received the Nobel Prize for Literature. I'm not so sure that the mass is reading, but they know of his existence. Nathan Alterman, who is a very great literary figure, and as I said before, the national poet of modern Israel, recognizes the national poet of modern Israel, and really a cultural icon in our country is totally unknown beyond Israel. And Dean Mitchell was very, very curious to know about him. So I made a short synopsis, and then she wanted to know about my work, how I came to write a biography of Nathan Alterman, what was the procedure of my writing. And then she stopped me and she said, well, you should share this experience with the students. I said, why? They don't know of him, they never heard of him, why should they bother? She said, we want to bridge between cultures. And of course I agreed. I wouldn't dare not to agree. And then I offered the somehow maybe vulgar title, for God's sake, who is Alterman? By the way, it's not a quote of Mitchell. She would never express it herself in this style. This is my own, but it expresses kind of an expectation that I would assume that people may have when they hear that someone in the United States, for example, is coming to talk about Alterman. I'll split my very short talk, which is up to 20 minutes. I took already 5, so 25 minutes. I split my short talk to 4 sections, 4 parts. I want to talk about method. I want to talk about the person. I want to talk about experience. And I want to talk about perception. These are the 4 parts which would allow me really to speak about the subject matter, but to go a little bit beyond the subject matter. Few words on each of these subjects, and this will be my presentation today. First of all, a word about method. I am a strong believer in biographies as a legitimate and important medium, genre, in academic studies. I didn't invent it, but as you may know, biographies were not very much respected in the academic world decades before. They were done by writers, journalists, but nice biographies, but it was not part of the academic profession. I think that there is a very important development in recent decades towards biography. It became legitimate. Great historians in many fields, or great experts in the academia, whether in the arts, whether in history, in other departments, mainly history, are writing biographies. And of course, they have turned or changed our perspective. We are learning, let's say, history not by speaking about trends or about movements or organizations or periods. We study the individual. And this is a whole change in the balance of our academic research. And the individual becomes the focus of our study. And it brings us to very interesting results. And don't take it for granted, because let's say 30, 40 years ago, it was not a commonplace. And still, now it's already accepted. Nevertheless, we should stress it and defend it and really make the point that through biography, you have tremendous new options and vistas of studying, let's say, history in the broad sense of the word, with the individual at the center. Speaking about literature, and I come from the literary scholarship, this is my background. I studied Hebrew literature and English literature and comparative literature, whatever you have to study in order to get finally a job in some university in the field of literature. So in my field, there was a long prejudice against biographies, not so much in history. Because, as you may know, and even in this university, there was a great tradition, the Chicago School of Criticism, but in other places, particularly in the United States, there was, in the broad sense of the word, this trend of new criticism, which was very, very influential. It said, we don't care about history. We don't care about context. We want the text itself. It doesn't matter who wrote it, the death of the author. There are a lot of slogans that were cultivated. There was a famous article by an English scholar, The Intentional Fallacy. We don't care what was the intention of the writer. We want to see the text and decide ourselves. Perhaps in some letter or some speech or some statement, he said something about his work. This doesn't matter. I want to see the lines, the page. I don't care what's his name. I want to understand. And this was a very, very strong cult. And I grew up in Israel. I went to the university. This was my formative years. And the cult of new criticism was a doctrine that you have. You were forced to accept. And personally, I won't get into all these things. I had to go through a very big change. And radical things have changed, but very gradually, because in the field of literary criticism, things in America changed before. Richard Ellman already and Leon Edel, like two or three decades ago, wrote the biographies of Oscar Wilde and Henry James. Here it was more accepted. In Israel, it was even worse. But also in the United States, people had to struggle to defend biography because this was not the mood. This was not the line. The cult of the text itself. And biography, of course, or first of all, historical study of literature takes you away. And I turned to become a historicist in the field of literary criticism, and then a biographer. And I think that I should say a word, I should have said, and I think I said it, in defense of biography as a tremendous tool. You can do other things as well. And I don't despise other methods, but I think that biography as a genre, as a tool, gives you tremendous opportunities in the field of literature. Of course, it doesn't refer only to the text itself. There is the life of the author, the period, his family, the private sphere, the public sphere, the works he's written, and you try to reconstruct the whole. But the individual genius is at the center of your work. And the same we do in recent years in other fields of the arts. Composer Benjamin Britten gained a beautiful biography. Picasso, his biography is written in parts in recent years, etc., etc. This is far as the method. Now about the person whose name is Nathan Alterman. He's the hero not only of my life, of I think of the Israeli community, the Klaj, and he's the subject matter of my biography. And it was almost natural for me, after writing the biography, daring to write the first full biography of the greatest prose writer in the Hebrew language in modern times, that my next step would be to write the biography of the poet that we consider to be number one. If we had a playwright on the same level, we don't have one. But if we had, maybe this would be my next step, but I will not. I hope that I will manage to speak on my present step. So it was natural for me to shift from Agnon to Nathan Alterman, in spite of the fact that really Agnon is, after all, an international figure because of the Nobel Prize, and Alterman is kind of a local hero. But for us as Israelis, as readers of Hebrew literature, he is the poet by whom we are inspired, I think, more than any other poet of our time. A few words about his life. I'll be really very short. I need 1,000 pages. And sometimes I'm asked by people, why did you write such a long biography? So I said, it is an abridged biography. Because, believe me, like a few years ago, Professor Frank, I think, in Princeton, finished a biography of Dostoevsky in 5 or 6 volumes. It took him 30 years. He was lucky. He started at the age of 60, and he took probably a calculated risk and managed to finish. But I took a decision. One can decide really to go on a 5 volumes biography, because there is enough to say about, there is so much to say about Alterman that you can get, but I wanted something, a bridge, in order to get to the reader, and I'll speak later about the reader when I get to the issue of reception. Nathan Alterman was born in Warsaw in 1910 and passed away in Tel Aviv after unsuccessful operation that he didn't survive in 1960. He lived less than 60. He died just some months after his 59th birthday. But you know, there are artists, there are geniuses that live relatively, in our terms today, a short life, and you know, they lead 5 lives. Franz Schubert died in his 30s, you know, and nobody can compete him. And I can give so many examples that really, if you get into the things that Alterman did, it's just amazing. But to give you a short idea about the scheme of his life, he was born in Warsaw to a Russian Jewish family. By the way, his father was an eminent educator, it's important to understand, and his father was one of those few at that time that thought that Jewish education already in the diaspora should cultivate it through the study of the Hebrew language, which was innovative. Not a generation before, fought struggle for secular education. But he went one step forward and struggled for Hebrew as an important, crucial tool for Jewish education. And his son, Nathan, was born 1910, was fortunate enough to know Hebrew from a very early childhood. Then the family immigrated, moved when World War broke from Warsaw to Moscow, and then when the Bolsheviks came to the Ukraine, and when there was a new anti-Semitic then government in the Ukraine, they moved to Chisinau, which was then Romania. Finally, they came in 1925 to Tel Aviv. He was 15 years old with a family, very soft kind of immigration. His father was an eminent figure in the educational administration in then Palestine. Then he went to a Hebrew gymnasium in Tel Aviv. Then at the age of 18, he traveled to France, you would imagine, to study cultural engineering, because he wanted, or his parents wanted him to gain a profession. So they didn't think that he should study in any divinity school, in humanities. So he went to the Sorbonne. He took, first of all, science classes, and then he went to Nancy, and there he studied and got his degree. He came back to Tel Aviv, and after 3 months he understood that he should move to writing. He was writing all his life. I found his poems that he has written in Hebrew, by the way, since the age of 9, and they are included in my book. And from that on, for a period of 40 years, he really emerged into the status of the main literary figure of his time, and his imprint was felt everywhere. He made a tremendous breakthrough in Hebrew poetry, lyrical as well as epic poetry. He wrote a lot about, he was a very prolific writer in the political sphere, and to that I would add a very crucial note regarding him. He wrote plays. He wrote for the cabaret theater, which was very, very popular for years, and he wrote like more than 1,000 songs, which he worked with composers. And by the way, if you go to Israel and you open the radio, within 24 hours, you will hear one of the beautiful songs that he composed. He wrote poetry for children. He was an amazing translator. Coming from France, he gave a diploma in cultural engineering, but he gained knowledge of French literature. He is the ultimate translator of Molière. There are all plays of Molière to Hebrew. Racine, he translated from Russian, from German, from English. And always I say, when I read his Othello in Hebrew, I say to myself, Shakespeare would have been proud, because it's an amazing translation of Shakespeare to Hebrew. I should say a word about his political writing, because this is, after all, his claim to fame, though everything is relevant to his immense influence and success. He established already in the early 30s a weekly column in the Israeli paper Haaretz, which exists still today. After 10 years in Davar, it's the Labour Party newspaper, a column where he wrote a weekly poem on current affairs. Mm-hmm. So it is a poem, but the content was political. And for 40 years, he was present in our public life through that medium, which was tremendously influential. And there are piles of information that I can bring up to show you. I even gave a seminar at the university speaking about this column, and I called it an institute of one person. And this column, you should understand, was written in the 30s, during World War II, the Holocaust, during the struggle of the Jews in Palestine against the British for independence, during the War of Independence, and then in the formative years of the State of Israel in the 50s, in the 60s, which means that he was there in the formative years of modern Israel, and he gave the vocabulary to that period. And everybody went through the education in the Israeli schools would know by heart a poem called The Silver Plate, written in December 1947, when the United Nations decided that the Jews would have their national home in Palestine. And he wrote a poem about the war that will come, the state that will emerge out of it, etc., etc. And everyone recites this poem, because this is part of our national consciousness. I put in brackets, I'm here as a visiting professor of Israel studies, and Israel arouses a lot of interest in the world, for better and for worse. But you can't understand the DNA of modern Israel without getting into the poetry of Nathan Alterman, because he represents the DNA, maybe he is the DNA. He was a writer of tremendous historical intuition, and he got in very many moments into the essence of our collective soul. The world about experience, I'll keep the time frame, I'll finish it one. Experience. Something about my work, I wouldn't say too much, time is short. Nonetheless, I would like to say that for the last five or 6 years, I went in the footsteps of the author. And you go everywhere. You read all his stuff. By the way, not what you find on the shows. He wrote more than 1,000 items which were published in the newspaper. I felt myself obliged to read them in the newspaper, to see them in live broadcasts, to see what was written next and what was written after. What was the caricature at the very same day when he published his poem? And you get a totally different perspective. You read him through, let's say, the daily newspaper, paper, etc., etc. You go to the archives. It seems banal. It's the greatest experience of my life. You find there unbelievable materials, the correspondence that he had with the manuscripts of his poetry between the age 9 and 21, which he never published. You get the correspondence with his mother, his sister. The correspondence with his mistress, that was, by the way, known by everybody. You get some of manuscripts, he didn't leave many, or whatever. Then I went and looked for oral testimony, members of the family, fellow poets, actors. I went to the president of Israel, I had an audience with him, Shimon Peres. He knew this writer well. By the way, Alterman was very much Pro Ben Gurion, was the person that actually created modern Israel, and Paris was next to Ben Gurion, and Altman believed very much that Paris will be one day one of the leaders of Israel. And what I did most, and I told it to Margaret Mitchell, and she was impressed, I traveled to each location that this writer has been it. In this case, I would love to write a biography of Hemingway, because using this method in regard to Hemingway would make my life much more interesting. So I went to Warsaw to see the place where he was born. And I went to southeast Belarus to see the small village where his father and mother grew up, where the story of the family actually started. And I went to Paris and then to Nancy to get to the places where he took his degree and maybe absorbed other things. And I went even to New York. You'll be surprised, because Adam had an only daughter by the name of Tirza Attar, a very, very gifted poet and also actress at the time. She's a very adored figure in contemporary Israel, and she went to New York to study acting, and she had a terrible nervous breakdown, and he was called to save her life. He never, by the way, after his studies in Paris, never left Israel. Nothing interested to go abroad. He was a great translator of Shakespeare, but he could do it in his home in Tel Aviv, and he was called to save to New York to save her life, and he went there, and I traveled to New York in order to see exactly the place where she was located, the school where she studied acting, the streets in which she went during the night after being in her apartment and going to his father. Finally, he brought her home, and she was stabilized. She committed suicide 7 years after his death. She's kind of the Sylvia Plath for, alas, of Hebrew literature. So I think that this traveling is not just a game. It really brought me to unique places. And when I was interviewed about my book, so sometimes I was asked, how is it that your chapter on his visit to New York is so moving. And I said, frankly, I couldn't have written it this way if I've not been physically on the place. I dedicated one page, not more, two pages, to this small shtetl in Belarus, where his father was born. To go to Belarus, believe me, it's not so simple. And not to Minsk, the capital, but to southeast Belarus. It's a real adventure to get there. I said I wouldn't be able to write, to mention the name of this small, forgotten village were I not, if I would not be able to see the place and be sure that it exists. One last word about reception. I have nothing against the ivory tower. We all live in an ivory tower, and we can't build a civilization without university, without academic institute, without our most sophisticated research. But sometimes we get a feeling that we don't connect. We don't get out of the ivory tower. We should share our knowledge with other people, you know, from the community, the great leadership. There are wonderful books written in the academia, but many of them are for our own use, which is, it's not bad, but this is the fact of life. I think that biography is one of the tool that you can make the breakthrough. The biography, in my opinion, is a kind of a repetition or variation on the 19th century novel, which was so popular. What was the 19th century novel? You took a person and you followed his life from birth to death, and you depicted the world around him. And it was really the name of the game. Right now, we don't write any more biographies of this kind. But in a certain way, we don't write novels of this kind. In a certain way, the contemporary biography is the variation of the 19th century novel. And in this way, we can gain an audience. We can gain readership. And the biography is one of the few genres written in the university with which you can go outside. My personal book, and I don't want to be too proud, it was had three editions within 2 months. It was for 12 weeks on the bestseller list in Israel of nonfiction. I had a lot of media. I had an evening in Tel Aviv just to give a feeling with Amos Oz. There were hundreds. Hundreds that were coming there, and I don't take it necessarily to my credibility. I wrote a fairly decent book on a very major writer, but I think 40 and more books were written on Alterman. It's not the first book, but only the biography, because it is a biography, made such a breakthrough. And when I was on my way to Chicago and got to the Ben Gurion airport, and I had a few minutes before I went on the plane, I just bumped into the bookshop in the airport, and I happened to see a pile of this book there, and they are very stingy as far as the place they donate to each other. And somewhere, I felt at that moment that maybe I have fulfilled my mission. Thank you very much.
We have time for a few questions for Professor
Laor. Why did he not change his name to something more?
Oh, this is a very good question. And there was really, really a fashion of changing your name, because, you know, I won't enter the whole issue of the old Jew who came to Palestine and Israel and invented himself, made a restart, and the invention of the new name was one of the invention of part of the invention of the new Jew. And many writers changed their names for generations. Alterman refused. And he was very traditional in many ways. And once Ben-Gurion wrote him, I have all the correspondence between the two, he admired Ben-Gurion, and Ben-Gurion admired him and really thought of him as the national poet of Israel, and he liked his political poetry. And Ben-Gurion wrote to him a letter, and then there was a P.S. Why shouldn't you change your name? You need a Hebrew name. And I don't like your name because Alterman means old man. Alterman in German and Yiddish means old man. And you are a young man. He was then in his 40s or something like that. So he listened and didn't obey to Ben-Gurion. And people usually obeyed to Ben-Gurion and changed the names. It shows that in many ways, and I can show it in other ways, he was a man, he was secular, he was contemporary, but his identity, personal identity as a son of his father was a really persona grata, was meaningful to him, and he didn't want, I think, to play with this collective change of identity through this particular move. It's interesting. It can be more elaborated, but I mentioned in my book this correspondence with Ben-Gurion, and he insisted to keep his old name. And really, most of the writers, many of the writers, not all of them, in his generation, some of them you may know, changed their names from a non-Jewish, non-Hebraic, not non-Jewish, non-Hebraic to Hebraic. And this was a part of a certain conservative side, I think, of his personality that has to be deciphered. Yes, please.
Do you have a plan to translate your book into English?
Well, I personally didn't have it. It didn't occur to my mind because I thought, well, it's a local phenomenon, and I'm writing a book that is relevant to my own vicinity, and I'm very happy about it. But recently, I got a letter from the Brandeis University. They have some series in Israel studies. And they are thinking that it's worth translation. And they consider it. I don't push for it, but if people around me will think that it is worth translation, I'm not against it, but I'm not passionate about it, and I'm not so positive that it is really needed. But maybe after this meeting in which you've been really, and I appreciate it, so attentive and interested in what I was speaking about, this is my impression, my subjective impression. Maybe one should think about translation.
Yes,
maybe. Yes.
That's
because of the initial. Oh, the initial. I was mentioning it. I wasn't careful. I haven't been in the beginning.
I came in just when you began method.
That's much better.
And I want to ask if I may.
You are to be blamed for this.
I am. This was a splendid talk. Yes. And if I could add a fifth category of style, you mentioned, you know, that you have worked on the greatest prose writer, Agnon, and the great poet, Alterman. How did you think about your own literary style in Hebrew, writing this biography? Also cognizant of your fourth point, that did you write in such a way that a broader audience could actually come on board? And so how did you think of your own
style? Well, I would think of, as far as time is concerned, I would like to make two comments, not to be too long, much more can be said about it. First of all, in those two cases, the writers, particularly Agnon, because he wrote prose, but their style, their language is so powerful, you needed a tremendous, you had to invest tremendous effort in not writing in their style. There was a danger that you would be trapped in their own mode of writing. By the way, Alterman wrote a lot of prose, mainly essays, but both of them are very powerful writers as far as language. And sometimes there is a tendency in some way to be drawn by the language, to imitate the language. When you paraphrase his novel or his poem, you might fail in writing in his language. And I was very much aware that I have to keep my own autonomy through language. This is number one. Number two, definitely yes. I was writing, Virginia Woolf called it the common reader. Nobody knows exactly what she meant, but let's say for the sake of discussion, I was writing it with my face to the common reader. I was passionate to make a breakthrough and share this story with a broad readership. By the way, this is the legacy of biography. If you read Richard Ellman, and you come from certain education, you get to it. And this is the power of biography. You can make it, and in my opinion, you have to make it. Some didn't before me, and this was very important for me, really, to write for a broader audience, and maybe beyond style. One of the great difficulties, if you take this position, just for give you a word, there are some very, very complicated poems, long poems. They don't speak about lyrical poetry. For example, during World War II, he wrote poetry, I mean the artistic, the non-poetic poetry, which is very symbolical and relates to the struggle between Nazism and the free world, but in the broad, let's say, even metaphysical sense, it's very hard. So I was passionate to present the poem in a way that the reader that never came across this poem would be able to follow me. And I was aware at the very same time that a sophisticated reader who knew the poem and maybe knew the scholarship around this poem. Now this poem, there are three independent books written about this poem, will still find interest in my description. I wanted both of them. And this is a very, very fragile ground to walk upon, and I hope I didn't break my leg, but it's not easy actually to direct yourself to the audience inside and to the audience outside. Anyhow, the fact that it came bestseller is very satisfactory from this point of view. It's not only success, it's the fact that really you managed to share your knowledge with teachers, with broad audience of readers. For me, it was crucial, but I didn't invent the system. People did it before me, and you were probably, I would imagine, familiar with some of the major biographies of writers written in America, from which one could learn a lot. So, and they had a position about style.
I think we have time for one more question, Andy.
You mentioned that you could have written a much longer biography, and I was curious what
he
left out and
why. I left a lot. For example, he wrote more than 1,000 columns in the newspaper for a long 4 years. He spoke about everything. I couldn't. And I had to do a selection. Should I write about his attitude towards the complex issue of German-Jewish relationship, which is very, very central to his thinking, or should I write about the split in the kibbutz movement in the early 50s in Israel between left and right, which was a sensational event. And I decided I'm writing about this. I will not mention the other thing. So this is one example. And I had to skip. I also, for example, I took, for example, the poem I mentioned before, called The Joy of the Poor, Simchat Ariyim, very complex poem, and I decided, and books were written about this poem, and every word was discussed. So I decided I don't discuss this poem beyond 25 pages, let's say, grosso modo, because then I break the plot. A biography needs a plot. And I know that not everybody is like Terry Prodan Laor. And I was also attacked. You should offer more detailed interpretations of his work, and because really there is a scope of interpretation, and maybe his work deserves, but not in the framework of a biography, because there is a constant struggle between the rhythm of a biography and the rhythm of a close reading of the text. So I squeezed it down. But certainly, if I would have written 5 volumes of biography, which expects a different kind of reader and a different kind of readership, and plans to get to other kind of results, I would get more into detail also in interpretation. And there are more to say, but time is over. I'm afraid, yes.
Let's thank Professor Lambert.
We thank you for listening to or viewing our podcast. For more information and for other podcasts, please see our website, divinity.uchicago.edu/podcasts. Copyright, the University of Chicago Divinity School.